Casagrande Chats, a podcast dedicated to the Loud House spinoff series, The Casagrandes, and I'm your host, Sunny, and welcome to episode 14 of Casagrande Chats, and we have a lot of stuff to talk about today with news and a lot of episodes that came out for the Loud House and the Casagrandes, but I'm actually not alone today talking about all of this stuff on the podcast today. I have a very special recurring guest coming back on my podcast. She is, of course, my best friend in the fandom. You all know her. It's Wyoming Parmesan, aka Nat. Welcome back to my podcast, Nat.
Yay, I'm happy to be here, especially because we have a lot of really fun stuff to talk about this time.
Oh yeah, of course, and I wanted her back on my podcast because this week, of course, the Lobby episode premiered, and I knew, like, the one person I knew to talk about Lobby with was Nat, of course, so we are going to talk about that later.
Yes.
So, but first of all, let's get into some Casa news!
Hey, it's me, Ronnie Ann. If you like the Louds, come meet my family. My mom, my brother, abuelo, abuela, tio Carlos, tia Frida, my cousins Carlota, CJ, Carl, and Carlitos, and our pets Sergio and Lalo. We are the Casagrandes.
So the first item on the news this week is that we had two of the Lincoln and Ronnie and Ronniecoln vlogs come out, number 8 and 9. So number 8 was kind of like a challenge video where they kind of, first they did a staring contest, then they did like a what's in your bag video kind of thing where they kind of pulled out stuff from their bag. And Nat, I haven't asked you this because you haven't been on. How you been enjoying the Ronniecoln vlogs coming out?
Oh, I love them. Like, I have been watching them, like, every time they come out. And I think it's just fun because it's, like, I remember we used to want Lincoln and Ronnie Ann to do video chats together. And yeah. So now we get one, like, every week.
I know. Isn't that crazy?
Yeah. And so it's just, like, I think it's fun because, you know, they're basically the protagonists of those two shows. And so it's just so much fun that they're actually friends with each other and stuff.
Yeah, I know. Like, as I said before, this is basically just them feeding us content for the show because they're like, oh, we know you like Lincoln and Ronnie Ann so much, guys. So we'll give you this, but you have to wait in the actual show until they, like, come back in, like, season 5, you know? So that's the sad part about that. But then, like, at least they acknowledge us and are like, hey, we'll give you something with these two because we know you like them so much. And again, it is a weekly thing. Like, I always set my alarm to 10 a.m. to wake up every morning to check YouTube to see if one actually gets posted. And man, they've been chugging out all of these. Like, I don't know when, they'll probably stop eventually. But as of right now, I'm loving that they're giving us as many as they are right now.
Yeah, it's awesome. And I think they always come with, like, some kind of cute content. Like, I love that a lot of it is, like, not kind of, like, stuff that's trendy with, like, the kids nowadays, because it's, like, it's so much fun seeing them talk about that kind of stuff. Like, the one when they were talking, I think it might have been the last week one, where they talked about, like, the internet challenges and stuff. Yes. Like, that was funny.
Yeah, like, I love that one because, like, there was actually some kind of continuity in that one, where Roddy had said that she saw, from season 1, Making the Case, she saw the video that Lincoln entered in that contest. Yeah. Which makes you rethink that entire episode now, because we didn't see her in that episode. So now you're like, wait, she was there the whole time? She saw that video? So that must mean she must have saw the video he made about his sisters and the apology video he made.
And it was funny because you remember that she kind of hated him back then. Yeah. So of course she didn't vote for his video.
She voted for Hamster Cam, and he's like, Hamster Cam. And then, like, when they had the What's in Your Bag video, when she pulled out the ring from Horoscope, I had to pause it and be like, Ronnie Ann, why do you still have that? I'm like, what? Oh. And then he's like, oh, I'll come back and get it. I'm like, oh my gosh, like, she didn't even know she had it in her bag. And so it's like, oh, that little tiny bit of ship teasing on our part. Oh, yeah, that was a good one. And then number 9 came out today, which was the one where Lincoln learned Spanish. And I absolutely loved the concept of this one because it was also tied into the Casagrande Familia Sounds podcast that came out a couple days ago where they actually taught Ronnie-Anne a little bit of Spanish. So I've been waiting for Ronnie-Anne to actually, like, teach Lincoln Spanish in the show or, like, you know, speak Spanish around him. She kind of did a horoscope, but not really. So this one was, like, she was actually teaching him Spanish because he's taking Spanish and had to take a Spanish test. And I just thought this one was really good.
Yeah, it was about, let me see. Oh, I was going to say it. I apologize if this is wrong. Let's see. Lincoln aprende español. Lincoln learns Spanish.
Yes. Like, I just loved, like, hearing how Ronniecoln would say the words, because, like, some of the times she would, like, roll her R's.
Yeah.
And then Lincoln would go, like, I know, like, when she was trying to teach him how to say Sergio, like, or say, like, bird in Spanish, she, like, goes, I don't know how you say it, but, like, and, like, rolling her R's, and then Lincoln goes, Padro, like, with an H.
I gotta look up the word, because I forgot, but, I should have wrote down all the Spanish words for this.
It's okay. But,
pajaro.
Yes.
And she said, pajarte.
Yeah, yes, that was the way of her memory. Or, like, the one where she was, like, here's how you remember, cow. Like, you go to Dairyland for a...
On a... Vaca.
Vaca.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I thought it was a really great one, like...
Just... Yeah, that was funny. And then my favorite one was the one with Lana, because I always, like, when I look at the word now, I think of her because it's Rana.
Yeah.
And I'm like, Lana loves ranas.
Yeah.
Like, that's just so funny.
It is. It's really cute.
Yeah. And there's also, like, they had their podcast come out this past week, and that one was about Spanish, too.
Yes.
And so I'm like, they're trying to give Dora a run for her money.
Oh, she is. Yeah. So that's a good transition. Thank you for doing my own transition. This is why I invite her on the show. Anyway, so... So, yes, of course, we got the Casagrande Familia Sounds, which is the one where they were teaching Ronniecoln more Spanish because, like, some people in the fandom have kind of sort of complained about how Ronnie and Bobby have quickly picked up Spanish words, despite them in the main show not really speaking Spanish as well as their family. And then this one kind of, like, touched upon that, where it was like, oh, like, you still don't really know your Spanish that well, so we'll teach you.
Yeah.
Like, we'll teach the audience, but we'll still teach you. And then, like, go ahead.
Oh, no, I was... You can finish. I was just gonna say...
No, you can go. That's okay.
Oh, I was going to say, like, I have a reasoning behind that. Like, I think the reason why is because we only ever really saw them interact with the Louds. And the Louds don't speak Spanish.
Yeah.
So it wouldn't make sense for Bobby and Ronniecoln to say Spanish around them. Whereas the Casagrandes all of them, I assume, are fluent in Spanish.
Yes.
So, of course, they're going to speak Spanish around them.
Right,
so,
yeah.
That's what I think. But, yeah, like, I don't think it's weird, because it's just, you know, they speak Spanglish in the show, which I think is fun, because it's, like, you don't really have to know Spanish to know what they're saying, because oftentimes they'll kind of say it afterward, and so, yeah, I think it's pretty fun.
Yeah. And, like, the best way they could teach us some Spanish words is by a musical number! Like, they actually sung a song, like, Hector sung a song, and they all sang. I thought, like, oh my gosh, when they started singing, that Ronniecoln got to sing a line, like, I started bawling my eyes out. I was just like, oh my gosh, this is great. Like you said, this could be Dora a run for its money. Like,
yeah.
When I started this podcast, like, the one thing I was really excited for with the Casagrandes was learning more about their culture and learning more Spanish words, because I don't speak Spanish. I took Spanish in high school for 1 year, failed it, what can you do? But, you know, like, I was really intrigued by it. Now I'm learning from Nat, because she's teaching me all the Spanish words now. And this show, obviously. So, like I said, it's really, like, educational, too, like, in the way where they do teach you new words. When they say something new, I'm like, what does that mean? And Nat will tell me exactly what they said. They're like, oh, that's cool, you know? So, I think it's fun.
Yeah, like, one of the first things that, like, I took Spanish in middle school, and one of the first things that they taught us was all of the different family words. So we learned, like, mother, father, brother, sister, grandma, grandpa, aunt, uncle, cousins, like, all that stuff. And so I'm like, that comes in handy now with this show.
Yeah, it really does. So, like, I loved just I love that they connected that with the vlog. It's like, Ronnie had promoted her own podcast on her vlog. That was just really great. Because she was like, oh, I'm inspired by your podcast, so I did mine. And then Lincoln said he's going to go listen to it. So, you know, I thought that was a really nice tie-in.
Yeah.
So that means, kind of, I guess, like, the extra content has some continuity to it, I guess, then, you know?
Yeah. And what was that song? Oh, I'm not going to say the tune right, but it was like, Hablando Español con los Casagrandes, or something like that.
Yeah, speaking Spanish with the Casagrandes, or however it was.
Yeah, yeah, that was so cute.
Yeah, it was really great. Yeah?
No, I was just saying, yeah, because I know it'll probably never happen, but, like, I think it would be cool if they made an episode that was in Spanish and they just put, like, English subtitles on it.
Oh, my gosh.
That would be so fun. That was so... Oh, speaking of that, I actually saw the other day on Twitter, like, someone posted the Spanish dubbed version of the theme song mm-hmm. of the Casagrandes. Oh my gosh, it was so good.
Yeah, it was. That was really cool to see.
Oh. Yeah, just the whole thing with the culture, like, I think something about it, like, I feel like that's part of the reason why it exists, is because they've never really had, like, a whole cartoon that's just about a Latino family. Like, yeah, we have Dora. And there's been, you know, some shows on other channels that were about Latino people. But this one is about a multi-generational family. And, like, that's something that's really common in Latin American culture. So, like, I'm sure there's a lot of, like, Latino Americans who can relate to it a lot. And so,
oh, yeah, that's why definitely. I love it. Me too. Like, I just love how, like, you know, again, like we're learning about their cultures, not just like, oh, it is about a, you know, a huge Latino family, but they're also not afraid to, like, pull out those words and say them in front of them, but also, you know, clarify them to people who don't really understand, you know, like me and some and others out there who don't speak Spanish.
Yeah.
But I still think it's just really fun because, like, I'm learning something. I feel like I'm learning something every day I watch this show, you know.
Mm-hmm. I love it. Yeah, I feel like it in kind of what's the word? Oh, see, now we're talking about Spanish. I can't think of English now.
Yeah.
It kind of motivates, that's the word, motivates me to kind of practice Spanish some more because, like, that was something that I liked in the podcast too, was where like Carlos, he said that, like, Spanish is becoming, like, the second most spoken language in America, and so that just kind of means that if you are working in the public with people in a place where you're going to encounter those kind of people, it's probably a good idea to at least learn, like, the basics and stuff. So
yeah, exactly, because it seems like there are a lot of people who do speak Spanish nowadays, you know. That's a very mm-hmm. you know, common language for people to learn. I mean, you know, that's the one I wanted to learn when I was in high school, because, like, most of my friends, I had a couple friends who did speak Spanish, so when they would speak, sometimes they would speak words to me, and I'd be like, I have no idea what you're saying.
You know? Yeah, and it's, yeah. So I'm glad that there's kids that are learning it, and adults, too.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. So, again, make sure you check out the Casagrande Familia Sounds and the vlogs, because, again, those two were just great teaching us all about, like, just learning Spanish, of course, like Lincoln and everybody else that was listening to the podcast. All right, so then we're going to get into episode news. Let's jump over to the Loud House first. And we have two episodes that are coming out February 15th, which is after my birthday. So technically, I'm going to say it for now, I'm getting episodes on my birthday technically, because they're supposed to be Valentine's Day themed. So let's start with the first one, which is Singled Out. Feeling like a third wheel when her teammates find significant others, Lynn seeks a boyfriend just to fit in. So, I'm really interested in this episode because, again, Lynn feeling like she needs a boyfriend to fit in. I've seen this kind of, like, trope plot done before in other shows, but it just seems kind of an interesting thing to do with Lynn of all characters, you know? Like, what do you think about this episode?
Oh, I'm kind of, like, not really excited, but I'm more, like, curious about it. Because, like, I know we found out, like, I think one of the storyboard artists said on Instagram that Lynn could be getting a new love interest.
Yeah.
A few months back. But the thing is that, like, I don't know if this is, like, it feels like a trope that has been done in TV before, kind of like, you know, she could just go and find like a random guy and be like, hey, will you pretend to date me so that I can pretend I have a boyfriend so that I don't feel left out, and then they end up liking each other. Like, that's how I feel like it's gonna end.
Yeah, this reminds me of the movie 10 Things I Hate About You, which is where, like, there's this girl that everybody doesn't like, and all the guys persuade this one guy to actually go out with her, and then eventually they do fall in love. So I'm thinking, like, because Lynn is, well, Lynn, like, people aren't really, like, you know, attracted to her or kind of scared of her being, like, you know, aggressive and stuff. So eventually somebody will try to, like, go out with her. Or even there's this episode of Hey Arnold where Helga pays one of her friends to be her pretend boyfriend to make Arnold jealous. So that, I guess it'll be kind of like that in the way, except where she's not making anybody jealous. She's just trying to fit in with others. But again, like with Lynn, I never thought she would be the type to feel that way, you know?
Yeah, because I think, like, for her, especially, you know, being 13 years old, I can kind of understand it, though, because even though, you know, she has her sports, and those are pretty much, like, her whole life. Because, like, when I was her age, like, I wasn't into sports, but I was always, like, you know, my friends would be over here dating people, and I'd be like, okay, I'll just be here with, you know, my cartoons and my video games and all this stuff. Like, y'all have fun with that. And so, for her, though, I can kind of see it, because it's like, you know, there might be a part of her that kind of is, like, not really lonely, but she kind of just wants to know what it feels like to, you know, be in a relationship. So I can get that, especially at her age.
Yeah, yeah, I can understand that, too. I mean, like, or she could just be like me and just pretend to have a fake boyfriend, as I did. That was her age, you know? Like, everybody had a boyfriend. I just said, oh, I have a boyfriend. Nah, he's not real. I'm just kidding. But, yeah, it's going to be quite an interesting episode. Like, I feel like in the end, Lynn, I don't know if Lynn and the guy are going to end up together, but I feel like maybe she'll realize that she's just okay without a boyfriend. She doesn't need one. She's just fine on her own. She's not, like, desperate for it, you know? Like, it's not really her thing, you know? But again, you know, these episodes always throw us for a loop sometimes, so you never know. Like, she could get a new boyfriend. We don't know whether it's Francisco or somebody else, so we'll have to wait and see.
And it could be, like, it could be, like, they are kind of, like, how they're doing with, like, Saluna and Luani, where, like, it's the start of kind of like an arc for Lynn, because they're doing that with Luann and Luna, so might as well include Lynn in there too.
Yeah, that's true. But I'm still saying this. When we get in the Lenny Chaz episode, yeah, at TLH.
I was about to say, for real, like, Lori has a boyfriend, Luna has a girlfriend, Luann has a boyfriend, Lynn could be getting a boyfriend. Where is Lenny?
Exactly. It's like they set that up in Roy Lab Music, and yet they don't establish it at all. It's like, come on. We want the Lenny and Chaz episode. You gave us all these ship episodes. Give us the Lenny and Chaz episode. We'll stop asking. And then let's get on to another ship episode, which is Brave the Last Dance. Clyde recruits Lincoln and the gang to find out if a girl he has a crush on at school feels the same way. So we are getting another Clyde episode. We just had a Clyde episode recently, so it's nice that Clyde is finally getting more attention than he did before, because we had one episode of season 3, now he has 2. And again, this one is very interesting, because I didn't know that Clyde was going to get a love interest. When we first heard about Change of Heart, we all thought the you know, the exchange student that was going to stay with him was going to be a love interest, but kind of sort of not ended up being, you know, it's open to interpretation on that. But with this episode, he's actually getting a love interest, and we don't know who this person is. Some people think it might be Penelope, which I wouldn't be surprised if Penelope from Shell Shock, or it could be a completely different new girl we don't know. But what do you think about this episode?
Oh, I think I might be more excited about this one than the other one. Just because, like, I need someone else to ship Clyde with. Because he honestly has not really had many, like, unless you go for the crack ships, like, Clint or, Slide, which is Sid and Clyde.
Mm-hmm.
Because I kind of, like, I know some people ship him with Haiku or Penelope. Like, I kind of shipped him with Penelope, but, like, I don't think she's going to come back. She'll just be in the background. But so I'm really excited about that. And so, like, the fact that all of his the friends are involved, like, you know, it'll be like Rusty, Zach, Liam, and maybe Stella too.
Yeah.
And so, and seeing Lincoln as a wingman, oh, he's a good wingman. And I think the biggest part of this is that it also kind of shows that we're living in an era where Clyde doesn't really have a crush on Lori anymore.
Yeah, they really have not brought that up like recently. Like, I think the last time they ever referenced that was an absent-minded with like a little sight gag with Lori being his journal. But any other time, like in the comics or even recently around Lori, he's been chill. So I think he's over Lori. And again, like, even in Be Stella My Heart, he had a crush on Stella. So I think
Yeah.
Clyde is over Lori at this point.
Yeah, and like literally like Exchange of Heart, like that one just came out like last week, I think. And he literally called Lincoln to ask if he can get Lori to take them to the airport. Like he like in season one Clyde would have never done that.
Yeah, he'd be too scared to even approach Lori.
He would have never done that. So that was really cool.
Yeah, like I'm interested in how the group is gonna help Clyde, specifically with Stella now in the gang, because now that they actually have a girlfriend in their group, she could actually, as a girl, actually give him good advice to talk to the girl. Because I feel like they'll take turns, kind of. It'll be kind of like Stallmodder the way where they take turns trying to help Clyde with the girl, trying to convince them that there's somebody that really likes him. But I really hope. And I really hope they don't do this. I've said it on Twitter, but I hope they don't do this. Where Lincoln goes up to talk to the girl either thinks that Lincoln is liking her or saying something completely words like out of context. And Clyde is like, "Lincoln, no! I thought we were friends. Why would you
Yeah, oh my
betray
God.
me?" Like, I've seen that done in so many cartoons. And if they do that psych, if they do that gag, I will just no. I so don't do that. I swear to. I've seen that in so many cartoons where it's the wingman goes up to the girl, and the girl thinks the wingman likes him, and the one boy's just so upset, and Clyde gets upset. And it's like, Clyde, no, we're just friends. I swear, I like Ronnie Anne. Trust me. You know what's
Yeah,
funny
that
is,
one.
I don't wanna call anybody out, but I made a tweet about this on Twitter where Zay, he was telling, feeding me like. It was feeding me about the idea of what if Lincoln asked, because there's supposed to be a dance. So he was like, "Oh,
Yeah.
what if Lincoln asked Ronnie into the dance?" And I'm like, "No, don't you feed that into my head." And all of a sudden, I'm thinking about it. And I posted on Twitter, and Alex, the voice of Carl, liked that tweet. So I'm like,
Oh.
Alex, is there something you want to tell me?
Oh my God. It could honestly just be like he like at like we don't even see him ask her, like she just appears out of nowhere.
Yeah, because, like, remember, Isabella recorded for Loud House a long time ago, and since Horoscope came out when she was recording it, that episode she appears in is probably coming out soon. So I'm like, is she gonna appear? I don't think so. I don't want to say so, but if she just pops out of nowhere like a surprise where it's like, oh, like they're like, "Hey, Lincoln, who did you invite to the dance?" He's like, "Oh, someone special." And she just pops up like, "Hey," they all just like drop their jaws. Like, they're like, "Wait, how did you convince her? Doesn't she not like dances?" "Oh, she's very good. I'm very good at persuading her."
And you know that would be character development because do you remember he didn't want her to ask her to ask him to a dance?
Yeah, and now it's like, oh, I was thinking about it where it's like maybe he tells her there's like free flippies at the dance, so maybe that's what convinces her to go. But then deep down, she's like, I'll just go for him, you know, because I want to see him again.
And it'd be like she could talk to Bob, talk Bobby. She wouldn't even have to talk Bobby into coming with to taking her because he'd be like, "Oh, I can see Lori. Okay, I'll go."
Okay, yeah, I'll just drop you off. It's fine. Come on, TLH writers, let us on the crew. We'll write the episodes for you. But yeah, I'm more excited about just seeing Clyde try to talk to this girl, whoever the girl ends up being. I'm not sure, and we won't see like any promos or any pictures of that till I guess, during that week of the 15th, because there's no new Loud House next week or Casagrandes, apparently, so we're on a week hiatus as of right now. So,
well, we'll probably get a new vlog next Saturday, though.
Yes, that's true. And what's funny thing is we're going to get one on the 15th, so another late birthday present for me, so that's good. All right, and what if that one ends up being, like, a Valentine's Day special, you know? You never know.
Oh, my gosh.
Like, they're like, so we know that you guys ship us. What's that ship name you call us? Ronkin? Ronniekin? come on, TLH. Hire us. We got you. Anyway, all right, and then... And then, we don't know when this one's premiering. It said the 18th for these. These two episodes were originally going to air on the 15th, but they pushed them back because the other episodes are Valentine's Day episodes. So we are getting two other Loud House episodes that are coming whenever they are. I mean, right now it says the 18th, but that's a Tuesday, so I don't think that's true right now. So we're getting two episodes after that, which are Right or Wrong. Mom tries to convince a newspaper editor that her kids are perfect in order to land a parenting advice column job. So, this is going to be a Rita episode, and I remember the last one we had, which was The Right Stuff, wasn't my favorite episode of season 3 or any episode of the show at all. Like, I found it kind of boring. And I watched Rita Her Rights recently, and I'm not a really big fan of that episode either, but... I know some people kind of told me that this one kind of reminds them of, like, Present Tense in a way, but what do you think about this episode?
Yeah, I think it'll be kind of funny, because, like, I feel like when, like, if you look at episodes like Rita Her Rights and stuff, like, it kind of, to me, is, like, where, like, we all know that, like, you know, the Rita and Lynn Sr. love their kids, but, like, I feel like she kind of sees her kids as, like, monsters at times.
I mean, have you seen the Loud kids? I mean, they are monsters.
And so, I feel like this one is just gonna be, might be, like, a, not like a, like, a new version of Rita Her Rights, where she's like, oh no, my kids are fine, and then she walks in, and then, like, the house is on fire.
Yeah, like, it kind of reminds me of, in Friendship with Magic, they did an episode of season 2 where the CMC actually were, like, newspaper writers, so they kind of did, like, columns for the newspaper on, like, the main six is all, like, gossip and stuff. So I feel like maybe Rita will, like, write, like, fake stories about her kids and how perfect angels they are. And then, like, maybe a news reporter comes in and is like, we want to interview your kids. And they come in and, like, the house is destroyed. And they're like, well, that's not what I was expecting.
Yeah, I feel like that one can probably be, I think it'll probably be funny, if anything.
Yeah, but of course, the one we are all looking forward to is Perfect Gig. When the McBrides go out of town, they hire Luna to cat sit, but the job becomes more demanding than she imagined. So this episode we've been hearing about for a long time. This is the Saluna babysitting the cat episode we've been waiting for and hearing about for such a long time from Kevin, and now it is finally coming. I'm so excited because, of course, it's Saluna. How excited are you for this episode, Nat?
Oh, I'm so happy also because I posted about it back in April of last year, and, like, some people thought that it was fake, and it's like, well, I got something to tell you about that. Yeah, because I actually, like, I didn't want to say anything at the time, you know, because I didn't want Kevin to get in trouble, because I know that there were times in the past where, like, people would constantly ask him about stuff, and, you know, he's basically, like, breaking his contract to tell us stuff.
Yeah.
And so he didn't want people, like, posting it online. And, like, I kind of made that mistake. And so I was like, okay, I'm not going to, you know, if I ask him about anything, I'm not going to post it. And I don't remember what it was, but, like, I didn't even ask him about the ship episodes. Like, he just kind of told me about, oh, I remember what it was. Like, I told him that I enjoyed Stage Plight and Racing Hearts. And then he just said, oh, thank you. We also have these two, an episode about Luann and Benny going on a date, and then the cat sitting one with Luna and Sam. And I was like, oh, okay. So, yeah, I didn't want to say it at the time, but now I can probably, I guess I can say it. That, yeah, he told me about that.
Yeah. So. Yeah. It is hard for us fans when we do get in contact with the TLH crew that they have to be very secretive when they tell us stuff, because there are things that we know sometimes that they don't want us saying until it actually gets announced, because I remember when, like, in season 3, I remember this, when you post, like, somebody posted the selfie improvement title card, and I think it was Amanda who was the director, like, DM'd you saying, how did you know about this?
Yeah, I was like, oh, because I know, like, you know, the, what is it called? An NDR?
Yeah.
Non-disclosure agreement, yeah, like, anybody who works in, like, animation or any kind of TV, like, they're not allowed to talk about stuff until the network says, okay, you guys can talk about it.
Yeah. So,
yeah, it's not, and it's also, it's, like, one of those things where it's, like, well, even though we're dying for spoilers, we also don't want spoilers, because I think it's more fun to be surprised.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I remember when, like, we didn't know about King of the Cons, like, that episode wasn't even announced, and it just
came out of nowhere.
It did! We didn't know it was coming. Nobody heard about anything. Nobody said anything. It wasn't even, like, leaked out like all these other episodes are, and they're like, oh, Latin has special. Like, what? Where'd this come from? You know?
Yeah, that was crazy. And now, I think, yeah. So, now we have all these, like, random episode titles coming out, and it's just like, yay!
Yay! But these two episodes, we don't know when they're coming! Yay!
Nope.
But yeah, I am excited for this one, because we're going to get more Saluna. We got some Saluna content in the episodes we'll talk about later, but this will be the big Saluna episode we're all looking forward to, so I'm excited for it.
Yep.
And then for the, so that's all the Lattice episodes that are coming up. And for the Casagrandes, sadly, my show has no synopsis out for any episodes. We do have dates and titles for them. So the 22nd and the 29th are when the Casagrandes are coming back. And the episodes we have are Away Game, Monster Cash, Tread Game, and this bird has flown. And right now we don't have a synopsis for them. But I think the bird one obviously is going to be a Sergio episode. I heard, like, Miguel had said it at a convention once that there's going to be a Bobby and Sergio episode coming up. So I think this might be the one they're talking about. And then Away Game and Tread Game, I don't know, maybe those might be connected episodes, but I don't think they are, you know? They just sound like the same title as, like, Snow Way Out and Snow Way Down, where they're not connected but the same title. And Monster Cash could be a Carl episode, but again, I don't know, so we'll see what happens with those.
Yeah, for sure.
And let me see, so that's all the news that I have written down. Is there anything that you heard about?
Oh, yeah, there was one thing I remembered. Okay. Remember, apparently, Liliana was recording for the movie this past week.
Oh, that's right! I forgot about that. Yes! We finally have some update on the Loud House movie that's coming out. Finally!
Yep. So, yeah, it's not much because, obviously, like, they're recording the voices, so I think that means that we could possibly get a trailer this year.
Yes, like a teaser trailer.
Mm-hmm. Later this year. I hope so. Maybe at San Diego Comic Con.
Yeah, like, I'm so pumped. It would be, yeah.
And I'm just glad that, like, it's a, even if it's just recording and stuff, like, it's still, and we know, we literally know nothing about the plot or anything, but it's still a reassurance that, yes, it is being made. It is happening.
Yes, the movie is still happening. Like, you know, like, I know when before Girl Jordan left, she was working on the Loud House movie, so it is still happening. So
yes, and they hired they hired some new people for it too. So
yes, and of course now seeing that they're recording the voices, it is happening. The Loud House movie is happening. So hopefully, as the year goes by, we'll see more and more updates on the Loud House movie.
Yes, I hope so. Like when Netflix has their like, what is it like when all the like, you know, the companies talk about all their upcoming stuff, like, they could have it on there since it's coming out next year, so.
Yeah.
Yay!
And we're supposed to be getting Loud House on Netflix eventually. I don't know when, but
I hope so. I think that would be good promotion for the movie.
Yeah, it would be. Like, I know it's supposed to be either this year or next year. I'm not sure, because I know they have that deal with Nickelodeon and Netflix to make new content. And I know Loud House is supposed to be on Netflix, because I know it is on Netflix in the UK, but as of US, it's not, so I know they're supposed to come soon. I don't know when, so.
I hope so, but yeah, that just made me so excited. So it was like, and you know, like they were doing stuff for like the Miraculous movie too.
Yes.
And so I was like, oh my God, we have both of these movies coming out next year.
That's right. They're both coming out.
We're going to be like, I was saying, like, if they both come out around the same time, I don't know how I'm going to handle myself.
Yeah, I know, right? Especially if Loud House movie gives us like ship validation to give us all the ships in one movie. And we get like Lady Nor and Adrianette and the Love Square in the one movie. Then we get like Lobby, Ronniecoln, and Saluda, and Wanny, and whatever ships they give us in the movie.
Oh my God. They're going to give us stuff to talk about for a year.
Oh, yeah. I mean, they're going to give us enough stuff to talk about with all these ship episodes that are coming out. I mean, 3 ship episodes in 1 week. That's, like, crazy to me. Like, you know?
Oh, my God, yeah.
Like, I just can't believe that. Like, I remember, like, some of us were, like, say, like, oh, the Loud House never really does romance subplots and all that stuff. And all of a sudden, TLH is like, you want Loud House ships? We'll give you Loud House ships.
Oh, my gosh, yes. Yeah, but yeah, it's going to be so much fun whenever we get more information about that.
Oh, yeah, I can't wait. So, yeah, I guess, was that everything else that came out with news this week?
Yeah, I think so.
Oh, wait, almost forgot. The plushies! Forgot about the plushies!
Oh, that's right, yeah. So, yes. They're coming out with these plushies for crane machines, like claw machines and stuff, and you can buy some of them on eBay.
Yes,
there's someone selling them on eBay for like $30, but there's Lori, Luna, Luann, Lynn, Lincoln, Lucy, I think, was there a Lana or a Lola one? I don't
know.
No,
but then there's
no,
there wasn't. Bobby
and Clyde. Yeah.
I'm so upset they made Bobby but not Rania. Come on! She's literally the main character of her own spinoff now, and they still deduce her to, like, no merch. Like, come on, guys. Give Rania some credit now. You make her brother, but not his sister. Like, come on, guys. Come on.
Yeah. And that makes me hope that, like, maybe since, like, I know that the thing, like, Wicked Cool Toys isn't the ones who made the other plushies and the figures aren't making Loud House stuff anymore, but since Nick has this new deal with Toy Factory, I hope that they'll make some more toys.
Yes.
As well. Maybe some that you can't just get in claw machines, because I suck at those things.
Yeah, I would not be able to get those out of the claw machine.
No, I would be like, someone needs to just go find a bunch of them and try to get them all and then sell them to us. Like,
yeah. If anybody from Toy Factory is listening, please make a Ronnie-Anne. I will beg you. I will pay you to make a Ronnie-Anne for me. I need my girl in plush form, I swear. I have a Lincoln. Yes. I need Ronniecoln in plush form. Lobby in plush form is great, but Ronniecoln in plush form is what I need right now. yeah. So yeah, those are coming out. I don't know when they're coming out. I guess they're coming out soon in like amusement parks and claw machines and stuff. So that'll be kind of cool.
Yeah. If someone is selling them on eBay, then they have them somewhere.
Yeah, because I know a bunch of my friends have bought the Lynn one, which they came like really early, so they have that already.
Yeah. So somebody might be in contact with like someone who has a claw machine full of those, and they're just like selling them.
I will buy your entire claw machine so I can just get all the plushies. It's like, here you go. This sells them online. Here you go. They're all of them.
Yeah. But even now, like, that is, honestly, though, that's a good way to get me to try to play those games, though, because even if you go to, like, some arcades and stuff will have where you get tickets and then you can get prizes. Like, if I saw one of those, I'd be like, I need 500 tickets.
Yes. Because I know altogether they sold them, like, $150. Like, no way am I buying all of them for $150.
No. Mm-mm. But, yeah, I'm going to be on the lookout, like, at the arcade and stuff for those.
Yeah, so that's really exciting that there actually is some Lit Loud House merch out there. Because I know, like, there's also the Nickelodeon Universe. They made a bunch of new Loud House shirts, too. Like, the Lincoln one, the Lori one. I know you have the Lori one, don't you?
Yeah. Yeah, and they're so soft, too.
Yeah, because I have the Loud House one that Hot Topic sold, but I want to get that Lincoln Long Sleeve Man with a Plan shirt because I love it. It's so cool.
Yeah, and they have them on Amazon as well. Like, I think the Lori one, they have it in a different color.
Yeah, and
than the one I have.
Yeah, and the Lincoln one they have in gray and white, and they have, like, I think they have a Clyde one that's, like, wingman.
Yeah.
And then, like, they have one with all the characters on, so it's really cool. So, yeah.
Yeah, I want that one.
So, make sure you just support all the merch that's coming out, guys, because if you buy the merch, we'll get more merch as they are with the plushies, so you never know. So, whenever these things come out, just support the plush and support the merch and all that stuff. All right, mm-hmm. So I think that is, again, I think that's all the news that came out. I don't think of anything else as right now with that. So we are going to take a break, and when we come back, we are going to talk about all the episodes of The Loud House and The Casagrandes that came out, which are Game Off, Deep Cuts, How to Train Your Carl, Copycat, and Flea Market. When we come back.
City with my big familia. Every day here is my favorite dia. One big house in our family store. Food and laughter y mucho amor. Tios, abuelos, all of my primos. A dog, a parrot, amigos. We're one big family now. Sundays and Mondays, they're all fun days when you're with the Casagrande. Mucha vida. Casagrande. Bienvenida. Casagrande. Mucha risa. Casagrande. We're all familia. Up to the rumbling train, the city sounds that fill my brain. Hitting the street and grabbing my board. It's a big city, so much to explore. Hanging on the block, skating at the park. It's totally fun from dawn till dark. Mercado below me, amiga above. Our Casagrande is full of love. Tios, abuelos, all of my primos. A dog, a parrot, amigos. We're one big family now. Sundays and Mondays, they're all fun days when you're with the
Casagrande.
And we are back to talk about all the Loud House and the Casagrande episodes that came out, which are Game Off, Deep Cuts, How to Train Your Carl, Copycat, and Flea Market. So today, two episodes of the Loud House premiered, which were Game Off and Deep Cuts. I'll talk about Game Off first because Deep Cuts had some good little Easter eggs in that episode. So Game Off was the episode where Lana wanted to play Lincoln's game because she got, like, so addicted to playing his game. But she had to find a way to distract Lincoln to keep him away from the game so she could play, but then she ends up screwing up. To play the game, she ends up screwing up and has to play the game all over again, so she has to distract him. And I thought this episode was so well done. Like, I already knew this episode was gonna be good, but, like, I thought it was fantastic. Like, I wasn't really a big fan of Mud Above the Lana episode, but I'm the first Lana episode this season, but I'm so glad she got two, and this one was just spectacular. Like, we haven't had a Lincoln plus sister episode in years. And this one was basically a role reverse, like in season one, where, like, Lincoln would do something where he screws up and one of his sisters was mad. This time, Lincoln was mad at his sister for doing something, and I had never seen Lincoln that upset at anybody ever, like, even at his sisters. Like, I know in season one, he was kind of, like, mad at them sometimes, but in this episode, it was, like, a very emotional moment where he just, like, got upset for Lana, you know, screwing up his game and going back and doing it all over again, and... You know, I posted a scene on Twitter where he does get upset, and it was just so well done to the point where it struck a chord with me because I was like, I never seen Lincoln that upset before, and it's just like, I just love this episode a lot. But what did you think of Game Off?
Oh, yeah. I thought it was really good, too, because it was like, like you said, it was a role reversal where it's basically, yeah, where, like, you know, the show started out as where it would always be, you know, Lincoln growing up and, you know, trying to figure out ways to get things to himself, and then his sisters would all gang up on him and get mad. And so this one I thought was kind of fun because it was like all of the sisters kind of having like their own little club without Lincoln, and then them trying to get Lincoln out of the house to distract him because Lana messed up. And so, and then like the end was the best part, honestly, because I just liked how, you know, that's kind of something that I want to see more in The Loud House. Like, I think when, you know, when we talk about seeing more emotional moments, like, that's the kind of stuff I'm talking about, how the ending was. Because it's like where, not, like, I feel like sometimes in cartoons they do this a lot where, you know, a character will mess up and then when they, like, you know, they'll try to hide it. And then when they confess to the other person that they messed up, the other character is just like, oh, you know, don't worry about it. And then it's like in real life, it doesn't always work like that. So I thought it was kind of fun to see Lincoln actually get upset about it because, you know, I would be too. But then he does, you know, he doesn't really stay mad at her for long. So I thought that was good too, because that's kind of how siblings are. We're like, you know, we do things that make each other mad. And then, you know, we might just need to cool down a little bit, like they did with him. And so, you know, let them calm down, and then you just go right back to being friends.
Yeah, because, like, even, like, that scene where, like, Lana was even asking, like, is there anything I can do for you? He's just like, just leave me alone. I was like, oh my gosh, like, I had never seen Lincoln that upset before, ever in the show, like, in any, like, an emotional way. Like, I didn't, when they were talking, like, the sisters were like, oh, Lincoln's gonna be mad, he's gonna be upset. I'm like, I'm thinking to myself, I know Lincoln as a character. I don't think he would get that mad. But, like, the moment he did, it actually shocked me. Because I was like, why is he getting so upset at a video game? But just the way that they handled it, where, yeah, he did, it took him 2 weeks to play this game and get to the final level and stuff. So, yeah, all his hard work didn't pay off with that and such. But just the way that he was, like, very just ignoring her, but then Lana, you know, made up for it in the end, and he wasn't mad at her anymore. It was just so well done. Like, I just, like you said, I want to see more of that in the show. That's how you handle an emotional moment in the show.
Yeah, like, it doesn't have to be dark. Like, you know, it don't have to be, you know, like, Steven Universe dark. It can just be, like, just something where it's more like the realistic kind of feels, where, you know, you want to hit people who can relate to that kind of thing. And so, like, I actually, on that part, I kind of felt bad for Lana, because I was like, oh, I hate, you know, I hate making people upset. And so, like, I totally get, you know, why she wanted to try to fix it, because, you know, you don't want to make people upset, especially not your siblings, because, you know, they're supposed to be, you know, they're the people who, like, you know, if you don't have anyone else, you have them. So, you know, I just felt bad for her, but I'm glad they made up in the end.
Yeah, exactly. Like, I just can't stop thinking about how good that scene was handled, because, like, again, like, I never thought that Lincoln would get that upset at Lana, but just, like, it was, like, I have to applaud Tex on his performance of Lincoln and that. The scene just, like, oh, so well done. And, like, the whole episode was really great. Like, I loved Lana's dream sequence where it was all, like, the 8-bit versions of Lincoln. Like, when he popped up in, like, the final boss, like, the way they made his kind of voice kind of sound robotic-like. That was just really cool to see. Like, I would love to see a whole episode where they're, like, just, like, the 8-bit Loud House, you know?
Yeah, that would be... Or even, like, a video game, because I think a lot of, you know, classic games are coming back. Like, they had Sonic Mania and, like, Cuphead and stuff. Like, so those kinds of games are coming back. So I think it'd be cool if they made a Loud House game.
Yeah.
Kind of like that.
And even, like, the sisters had some great moments in this episode. I mean, like, Lana got paired with Lynn and Lisa, who were helping her out in the episode. And, like, we had Lenny for a little bit, like, when I played that dancing game. We had Lola kind of bribe him to, like, get flippies with him. And even, like, I love how Lincoln just knows his sister so well, where he was like, that's unusually nice of you, Lola.
Yeah,
but he's like, I got a date with a video game. And then Lucy was in it. Like, I'm glad Lucy got to be in it for a bit, where it's like, okay, Lincoln denies free flippies from Lola, denies Lenny's, like, offer to go play a game, but a free zombie apocalypse room, now that's what convinces Lincoln to leave the house. And I just love, like, when Lynn gets the picture, how happy Lincoln looks when he defeated the zombie apocalypse room. And then, like, Lori got to be in it for a bit, which I'm like, man, they're pairing up Lori and Lincoln a lot in these episodes. We just had this community disservice where they were paired up, and now they're paired up again this episode. Like, I just, because again, I love Lori and Lincoln together, so I love how, like, they've been pairing them a lot lately in these episodes.
Yeah. There was.
Yeah, so I thought, like, again, I thought this was a really good episode. Is there anything else you want to say about this episode?
Not really, just that I thought it was really good.
All right, then let's get on to Deep Cuts. So Deep Cuts is the episode where Luna finds out that they're going to cut the music program, so she wants to find ways to, you know, make sure that her club doesn't get cut. But then two other louds, Lori and Boanne, both get involved because their clubs get cut in the way for the music club, for them not to get cut. And this episode was really, really good. Like, I was really excited for this episode, but for one reason, and one reason is that Sam finally came back! She's in the episode! We get a little bit of Saluna this episode! Woo! Yes, we get some Saluna. And we also got a surprise cameo from Benny, so we kind of got some Wanny in this episode, kind of, so... It was just so weird to me that we had Sam and Benny in the same episode. Like, that's just crazy to me. Like, I know the last time we kind of had them both in Ella's for Love, but to see them actually both on screen together in that one scene with all the people, like, fighting, that was just insane to me. Like, I never thought they would do that, but I thought this was a really well-done episode. And, again, we haven't had a Luna episode in such a long time, the last one with Racy Hearts, so now that she has this one, and then she's getting another one with Sam, of course, but Sam was in this episode, and her other band friends were here, too. But, yeah, I thought it was a really good episode. Having Lori and Wawan play in the episode, too, was good as well. Like, you know, I really enjoyed it, but what did you think of Deep Cuts?
Oh, yeah, I think I might have liked that one a little bit better than Game Off. But they were, like, you know, they were both pretty solid anyway. But I think it just kind of surprised me, like, the whole, like, the way that they went about it. Just, like, I think we knew that Lori and Luann would be in it because of the title card.
Yeah.
But I'm just glad it didn't end up being, like, another Brawl in the Family kind of thing because, oh... I'm glad it was not like that. Like, it, like, the fighting that they did was actually, like, realistic because, like, I would be mad too, you know. And so, and then, like, I thought the parts with Lincoln was pretty funny because I feel like when he's not the star of the episode is when he's the funniest.
Oh, yeah. I love the part where he just walks in, like, oh, we're gonna have dinner. And then he sees the fight and is like, okay. And walks away.
Yep.
I love when they put unnecessary Lincoln cameos in the episodes that don't need him. Like, it's just like, hey, he's here, and I'm like, I love him.
Yeah, but that was just funny. And then I was like, and then they had a song in there too, and I thought that was fun.
Yeah, the song was really great, especially seeing Luna, Lori, and Wawan sing all together. Like, I love seeing that pair together, but most of us are, like, kind of sad about Lenny not being in the club, though. She kind of...
Yeah. Because you would think that they would have, like, a fashion design club or something.
But I'm thinking because most clubs take place during after school, maybe because she has a job after school, she probably isn't in a club, but, you know.
Oh, that's true, yeah.
But, yeah. But,
it was just... Oh.
No, go ahead.
It was just fun to... Oh. It was also fun to see more of the high school, too, because... Most of the time, like, since Lincoln is the main character, we're always at the elementary school. So it's fun to see the high school. And I think maybe in that Lynn episode, we'll see more of the middle school, too.
Yeah, because, like, we got to see a lot of the drama kids from Stage Plight come back. And, of course, we got to see Luna, Sam, and their bandmates in this episode. And we got to see Lori's golf club because she's apparently in the golf club because she loves golf. So she's in the golf club.
Yeah.
It was cool. It's so cool. And we saw the principal of the high school. So we got to see all these unique designs for this episode.
Yeah, like, they had to make up a lot of brand new, like, background characters for these.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, that was fun. And I also relate to the principal so much.
Yeah, like the principal was kind of like a hippie the way it went too. One of my favorite lines of this episode were when the moment where she's upset at Lori, she just comes in screaming, like, you know, like, she's mad, and then, like, Luna comes in and she's like, "You be quiet, hippie."
And Darren said that he's the one that added that.
Yeah, and I told Darren, thank you for adding that, because that part literally made me crack up so hard. Just, like, I just love how Christina, like, that moment Christina was, like, they were like, okay, Christina, you as Wawan, you need to scream your lines the moment you come in there, and then you're like, shut up, like, be quiet, hippie. That was so, like, this episode was so funny. Like, just, like, the way they all got mad at each other and, like, were fighting and stuff. Like, it was such a hilarious episode.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, like, both of these episodes were solid. Like, probably some of the best of season 4. Like, I can't do a ranking at the moment, but these both were really just some of the best episodes of season 4, I would say, right now.
Yeah, right. Really good.
Oh, yeah. All right, so then let's move on to the Casagrande episodes. So we had a three-episode bomb that came out, which they all premiered at 7 o'clock. Don't know why they did this, but now they're moving back to Saturday mornings, as they should be with the Loud House, so they're doing that on the 22nd. But we had these episodes come out in the bomb. So the first one we're going to talk about is How to Train Your Carl. This is the episode where Carl and the gang, they all go to the zoo, because Sid and her family invite Ronnie Ann, Carl, and CJ to go to the zoo, and Carl wants to go see this Komodo dragon that he really loves, but of course Komodo dragons don't come out at night because they sleep. So Carl goes out to try to find the Komodo dragon, but of course gets lost, and Sid's mom has to go find him. And I was really excited for this episode because it was Carl's first focus episode, and Carl of course is one of the best characters in the Casagrandes, as I always say, and I really liked this episode. I thought it was a lot of fun for Carl's first episode as a focus, and you know, him and the monkey were a great team together. But I feel like that Sid's mom, Becca Chang, kind of stole the spotlight from how awesome she is, because not gonna lie, she's pretty awesome this episode. Like, she's so great. Like, she's so talented and awesome, and then, you know, like, she's awesome. But what'd you think about this episode?
I thought that episode was pretty funny. Like, honest, Sid's mom was scared, honestly, because she's just, like, literally knows how to handle those animals. And I'm glad that we saw more of her, because I feel like we don't see her that much. Like, we've seen more of Mr. Chang than we have of her, so that was fun to see more of her, too.
Yeah, and they've been building up the zoo for a while in the spinoff. Like, they talk about the zoo so much, but we never see it. And, of course, we had that zoo podcast a while back with Becca also on there as well. So now that we actually got to see the zoo for once, like, it really did, like, live up to the hype, because it looks like a really cool zoo. Like, and they were going to sleep there for, like, a sleepover, I guess. So I really hope we get to see more of the zoo in the future of the spinoff. Like, I hope this is not just for a one episode, you know?
Yeah, like, since her mom works at the zoo, I would think we'll probably see more of it.
Yeah, and this episode was, like, one of the first episodes. Well, I also say stress test for Ronnie, and didn't really have a lot of focus in this episode, too, which I'm glad about. They're starting to do kind of the things they're doing with her, where, like, with Lincoln, he would start having less and less focus and screen time. This episode, like, stress test, she didn't have a lot to do in this episode, so I'm glad to see they're starting to, like, you know, give other characters a chance to shine, like, you know, with Carl being the focus in this one. And of course, you know, Carl's always fantastic, so I think because it's Carl, it's a really good episode. I thought it was really funny just with him and all the hijinks he gets in with the monkey, so I thought it was a really funny episode.
Oh, yeah, it was funny, like, the part whenever the Komodo dragon was gonna eat him, and he's just sitting there like, la 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 la.
Yeah, like, yeah, it was just really fun. Like, I love the monkey. The monkey was hilarious. Like, mm-hmm. It was such a funny episode. So I really enjoyed that. And then we have Copycat, which is the episode where Ronnie Ann thinks that Carlitos doesn't like her because he's not copying her. And so she tries to find ways to get Carlitos to like her, but she eventually goes too far and gets Carlitos to like her a little too much. So she has to find another way to stop him from liking her so much. And I want to give a shout out to the Casagrande crew for confirming one of my headcanons that I've had for the longest time, that Ronnie Ann is so desperate for people to like her. Like, the moment where she was so mad about Carlitos not like her, she's like, I want him to like me now. I'm like, I can't believe they actually confirmed one of my headcanons I've been, like, thinking about for such a long time. After Operation Dad destroyed all my headcanons about Ronnie Ann, they're like, we'll throw you a bone for one of them. And I just love this episode because, again, like, with How to Train Your Carl and even Flea Market, Ronnie Ann hasn't really been utilized in this show, of course, because she hasn't been a focus. So now this episode, she's a focus again. I just loved all the ways she tried to convince Carlitos to like her, and eventually, you know, she got him to like her a little too much, so she was, like, stressed about, you know, Carlitos clinging on to her and such. And, you know, it's basically, like, it reminds me a lot of, like, Chaining the Baby from season one with Lincoln and Lily, in a way.
Yeah.
Or even there's a comic in the third issue of Live Life Lab, which is the Babes in the City, where she's babysitting Carlitos, and missed opportunity to call Lincoln, because it's like, who's the one person she knows that can actually, you know, help her take care of a baby? Would have been Lincoln, you know, missed opportunity, Casagrandes, you know. But anyway, but, like, you know, I really love this episode, just seeing her, like, go through the struggle of trying to get Carlitos to like her, but eventually goes too far, and she has to learn that, you know, like Frida said, you know, he's a baby. He'll eventually learn to like you. You just have to keep at it. Like, I know in Pranks from the Memories, which is another example of this. This is basically just Pranks from the Memories with Carlitos, where, you know, in that episode, she tried to convince Carlota to like her. But this episode did a lot more better than that one. And in that one, she had said Carlitos and her were close, but I guess they weren't too close at the moment where she was like, oh, he's not copying me, so he doesn't like me anymore. But the way they handled the ending, I just thought was so brilliant, where she was like, okay, I'm going to convince Carlitos to not like me, because, you know, after, you know, babies, after they like something and play with something, they stop playing with it and play with something else. So, you know, Roddy and eventually, like, started playing with Carlitos to get him to stop liking her so much, and I thought that was so well done. And so, yeah, so what do you think of Copycats?
Oh, I thought that one was really cute. Because, you know me, I love babies and stuff.
Yeah.
So I was like, oh, so cute. And I love how he called her Owl. Like, that was so yes. cute. Like, Owl, Owl.
Yeah, because she fell on her butt, and then he goes, ow! And she's like, oh, he likes me now!
It was so cute. It's like, I'm like, they're trying to prepare her for the future with having kids.
Yeah, because it's like, you know, that one scene where she was stressed out about Carlitos being around her, I'm like, oh, honey, just wait till you have 11 kids with Lincoln, then you'll see what true pain is like.
And then with Frida, like, being upset because she thinks that Carlitos doesn't love her anymore.
And then, like, she dressed up as Roddy and then flossing at the end.
Yeah.
I was like, no, Frida, no, I thought you were my favorite. Why would you betray me like this? And then, of course, we got, we knew about this character named Diego for the longest time, and we thought there was actually going to be an episode, but no, Diego was just a one-off gag.
He might come, I mean, he could come back, though, but we don't know.
That's true. I was like, wait, he's in this episode? Okay. Like, yeah, like, this, I thought this was such a good episode. Like, I need to watch it again. I loved it so much. It was such a great episode.
Yeah, and it made me think that, like, we need Carlitos and Lily hang out again.
Let's have Lincoln bring Lily to the city so they can have, like, a little play date.
Yeah, like, literally, the only interaction that they had was in The Loudest Thanksgiving, and, like, he threw mashed potatoes at her face.
Well, no, at the end, they were dancing together in the nacho cheese.
Yeah, that's right. Oh, that's right. But, well, like, their first introduction to each other, though, was, like, throwing food at each other. Yeah, that's right. They were vibing in the nacho cheese.
Yes. So then Lincoln and her both have babies since, like, they're getting ready for the future.
Oh, my God. Yeah, that could be. Oh, my gosh. They need to do an episode like that where, like, Ronnie Ann has to watch Carlitos and then Lincoln's like, oh, I have to watch Lily.
Play daytime.
Yeah. Like, oh. Do, like, two boys and a baby, except it's Lincoln and Ronnie Ann with two babies.
Oh, my God. That would be the most amazing episode ever. I mean, you know, like, Lincoln brought Rochelle to the city, so he's setting her up for the future, man.
Oh, that would be so great. Take notes, Casagrande's crew.
Yeah, that's right. You're listening to Casagrande's crew. Take every note that you hear from our voices, because we got ideas for you. All right, and then we have the big episode we're going to talk about today, which is Flea Market, which is the episode where Lori and Bobby are celebrating their pizzaversary, and Bobby wants to go celebrate that date with Lori, but of course he has to give up control of the Mercado to Roddy and CJ and Carl, which he doesn't want to because they're going to mess everything up, but of course he still has his date with Lori. And since you're my guest, Nat, I'd like you to go first on this episode because, of course, it is the lobby episode. What did you think of Flea Market?
I'll be honest, like, I thought that there was gonna be a little bit more shipping in it than there was, but the amount that we got was pretty good. So I thought I liked seeing we had Horoscope with Lincoln and Ronnie Ann, and then now we had this episode with Lori and Bobby, and so I just think it's kind of cool that, you know, even though they have long distance, like, they still are talking to each other and stuff, so they're still going strong. And I think I know a lot of people were on this episode for the fact that the way that Ronnie-Ann, Carl, and CJ acted. Mm. Like, but I honestly thought that they were kind of funny because, like, we never see Ronnie-Ann actually act like a kid. And I guess it's because a lot of the show is told from her point of view, so of course we're not going to see, you know, that part of her. But so I thought that this was more of, like, how Bobby kind of sees them, because it's like, yeah, a little, like, kids can be annoying sometimes. Like, they just really are. So I thought that was funny. And so then when you go to, you look at the lobby stuff, like, I kind of felt bad for Lori because she was, like, you know, wanting to have this date and stuff, but then Bobby's over here, like, being distracted by, you know, being stressed out about what's going on with the Mercado and all that. And then it's just, like, the part when, like, she gets mad at him, I was like, oh, snap.
Yeah.
You did it now.
You're with your other love. No, we're just friends.
And then, the old lady was like, well, maybe if I was 50 years younger.
No, I mean the Mercado.
Oh, gosh. Yeah, and then just, like, the whole thing with her telling him that, like, you know, some people have their own way of doing things, and you just kind of have to learn how to accept that. And so I think in a way, she's kind of talking about their relationship, too. And, like, it kind of reminds me of, like, the advice that, like, when she told, you remember in Racing Hearts, she told Luna about how her and Bobby, like, when they first started dating, they didn't really have much in common, but they kind of just had to learn how to, you know, deal, like, you know, learn how to deal with the way that each other does things and, like, the things that they like. And so I feel like that was just kind of going back to that where, you know, they're not. Oh, that's another thing is I kind of like that it showed that their relationship isn't perfect.
Mm-hmm.
Because I feel like they don't do it as much now, but, like, I feel like back in season one, like, you know, when Lobby was just, like, that really, like, stereotypical cheesy teenage high school relationship, like, they kind of treated their relationship like it's perfect. And Save the Date, I think, would be an exception for that. But then we see, like, you know, they do have their flaws. Like, I think at times it kind of seemed like, you know, Lori didn't really care as much about Bobby as she cared, or yeah, Lori didn't care as much about Bobby as, like, he cares about her. But, like, I think it's obvious that the feelings are mutual still. So, that's what I liked about it. And then, like, you know, the hug at the sweet. Oh, yes. My gosh. That was the best part.
Yeah, like, I enjoyed this episode a lot, especially with the lobby parts. Like, that part where you talk about the speech at the end, I made an analysis on this on Twitter where this literally reminded me of, like, the way she was like, oh, your family has a different way of going about things. I'm like, oh, she learned this from her own family. Because, like, in Guts and Glory, you know, like, she's basically Bobby in that episode where she's in charge of the house and she's strict and such, just like Bobby. And then, like, you know, Lincoln takes over because he feels like that he can do a better job. But then, of course, the loud kids cause more chaos. Then, you know, Ronnie and CJ and Carl really didn't cause a lot of chaos. They just, you know, changed the music and just did silly things. Like, the Lori's like, were they rude to any guests, burned the place down? And he's like, no. Like, the loud kids, they destroyed everything in their house. So, of course, Lori had to go back and take charge. So, like, she's like, yeah, like, you have to respect that your family, you know, your family loves the Mercado. They wouldn't do anything to destroy it. Like, you know, and she learned that from her family and from herself. And that's why she tried to teach her boyfriend that, because, like, and she's like, what I love about you is that you're so passionate about things. Like, this is, like, literally the first time I've ever really seen her actually, like, describe why she likes Bobby so much, because we don't really know why Lori and Bobby love each other so much, other than, you know, they're the typical lovey-dovey couple, but, you know, slowly they've showed that they're not this perfect couple. But, like, seeing how Lori loves how passionate he is, because, yeah, Bobby does so much for Lori, you know, he cares about her and does a lot of things for her, and she's like, yeah, I love how passionate you are about the things that you love. Like, she's okay with him loving the Mercado so much because she loves him. And, you know, the hug at the end, and he's like, thanks. It's like, it was really sweet. Like, I never thought that we would see Lori character development in the spinoff, but we did. That was really crazy. Yeah, and, like, the whole thing with Roddy and CJ and Carl, like, I feel like the only reason they did that was because they basically wanted to write Ronnie in out of the episode, but they couldn't find a way to do it. They were like, we need to write her out of the episode, so we don't really want her in it, but let's just do something where she's not really part of the plot. Because, like, even though I love Ronnie and CJ and Carl, I feel like they weren't really necessary to the plot. You could have just written them out and nothing would have changed. But, you know, they were kind of the obstacle to Bobby being all strict and stuff. But, you know, really, like, they really didn't, like, do anything bad to the Mercado. They just kind of changed the music and just were kids. Like, when Bobby went back, you know, everything was fine, but he was going way too far. And, you know, and then he got upset at Roddy Ann, which that's the scene where he got upset at Roddy Ann, and he's like, oh, you understand when you're older. And I'm like, wait, Bobby, you know this is the same girl that helped take care of you in Shell Shock. Like, you shouldn't be this bad at her. But again, like you said, like, we haven't seen that side of Roddy Ann in the show where she's childish. And you have to consider, like, you know, back in the day, like, when she was living with Bobby and Maria, she had to take on all this responsibility and stuff. But now that she doesn't have to, now that she lives with the Casagrandes, she could be a kid again. She doesn't need all that responsibility on her hands anymore when she's not a main character, you know? She could actually be a kid. Like, yeah, it did kind of upset me because I'd never really seen her act this way before. But it's like you said, where when Lincoln's not the main character, he acts like his age, and sometimes it's like, oh yeah, they're supposed to be 11 years old. They're supposed to be kids, so we can see them act their age. But, you know, it was a little played up for the episode, but, you know, like, it was just, I'm not, like, mad about it anymore. I'm just like, yeah, they're kids. This is the same kid. This is the same child that spent $100 in one day. So, you know, she could be a little, she could act that way, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought that was fun. Because, yeah, like you said, it is fun to be reminded that she's a kid. And kids are annoying. They do weird stuff. It's okay.
Yeah. And, like, it was just great seeing Lori in the spinoff for the first time ever. Because, again, like, we got Lincoln before Lori in the show. I still think that's crazy. Like, they actually decided to do that. And I know most people are saying that Lori might show up more than Lincoln because we all know that Lori's going to move eventually. But, you know, like, seeing her in the show for the first time, and, of course, the way they animated her was a lot different than the main show. Just seeing I just love how the Casagrandes, the spinoff show, makes, like, Lori and Lincoln in the show more expressive. Because, like, Lori's expressions in the episode were just really well done. Like, she's more, like, squash and stretch kind of thing. Like, she could do more expressive faces, like the little, like, heart eyes she did at Bobby, or just, like, the way she talked to him and the speech and everything, or the way she was smiling with a little dimple with him when they were talking on the phone together. Like, it was just, I just love the way they're just, like, really just doing a lot with the expressions in the spinoff. And then when you see, like, the characters from the Loud House come into the spinoff, it's like, oh my gosh, look how expressive they could actually be.
Oh, yeah.
More than the main show, you know?
Yeah, I love it. I love it. It is a very subtle difference, but you can definitely tell.
Yeah, and I just love how the Casagrandes really step up their game when it comes to the crossover, because, like I said, in Croats, we got the Loud House cameo, Willie the Loud House, and then in Horoscope, we got Lincoln from the show, and then we had Bobby going to Royal Woods to pick up Lori to go to the city in the spinoff. Like, that's just, like,
yeah,
the biggest galaxy brain ever. Like, I still think the ending of season one of Casagrandes will have such a big crossover moment, it will throw us off guard. Like, I just know, like, they were just like, let's, with these crossover episodes, let's just step up our game with these kind of things, because I still think this one and Horoscope are, like, one of the best episodes of the Casagrandes, because they really just, they just know how to treat our ships right, man. They really do.
Yeah, for real.
Like, come on, TLH, take notes! The Casagrandes are doing the ships better than you ever did.
Yeah, like, I think it's just the thing, the reason why we get, like, Ronniecoln and Lobby is because it's like, you know, those are the main two, the only two, like, Casagrande's characters that are being shipped with Loud House ones.
Yeah.
So, of course we're gonna get them.
Yes. And like we said with Ronniecoln, guys, give us more lobby. You know, we still, it's not, like, you can't stop it here. Like, you're just like, oh, let's make one ship episode. We're done. No, we want more, guys. So don't stop. We want more. Just give us more. Like, more Roddy Kid, more lobby. We need an episode with both ships in them. If we get an episode with both ships, like, that would be fantastic if we did that.
Like another City Slickers.
Or Save the Date, you know.
Yeah.
Like, give us that and we'd be satisfied. I'm trying to think of what else, like, in this episode. Like, this episode was basically Horoscope 2.0 because they go to the same restaurants, like, Iranian doing Horoscope. So I got, like, so many Horoscope vibes because, like, they were literally sitting in the same table in the same position because, like, Bobby was sitting in the same seat as Ronnie in that episode, which had the Cupid pointed towards her in that episode, and it was pointed towards Bobby. It's like, and then, like, one of the writers of the Casagrandes was liking a bunch of tweets that day that we made a bunch of about. He liked a ton of the tweets I made. And then the one someone posted the scene with Lincoln and Ronnie and Lori and Bobby at the restaurant. And I was like, I see you, Casagrandes. And he liked it. So I'm like, we see you, Casagrandes. We see you. We know what you're doing. Don't hide it. You know, Lori and Bobby are kidding, but Lincoln and Ronnie kids gonna be next. We know it. You can't hide from us anymore.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. It's just funny because I'm like, what are you guys not telling us?
What are you guys up to? Oh my gosh. Like, go ahead.
I said, I feel like, I know that, like, legally they can't take any kind of ideas that, like, you know, they get from fans, but I still feel like they're looking at us to see, like, I wonder if what we can do that would make these guys happy.
Yeah, I mean, Horoscope was literally built on, like, killing the fandom with, like, all the ship teasing. They're like, oh, they like Ronniecoln, huh? I wonder what we could do to, like, kill them. And then, like, Lobby's like, oh, they like Lobby too. All right, let's do that. And then it's like, oh, they liked Horoscope? Let's just do the entire episode just with Lobby. Let's put them the same seat. Let's do the same expression. Let's do the same position they were in. Let's just do that. Let's just make the connections. Because, like, we're always making, like, connection, but the show was like, we'll do it for you. So it's like they hear us, they know what we want. So, you know, I feel like the Ronniecoin vlogs were just built on us, like, telling them how much we want Ronniecoin. So, you know, but I'm trying to think what else I liked about Flea Market. You know, I thought it was great. And also just hearing Lori say Mercado and Abuela, like, just hearing her say Spanish words for, like, the first time around Bobby, that was really nice to hear, you know?
Yeah, that was cool.
Yeah, like, I really liked the episode a lot. Yeah, like you said, like I said before, like, I still think Horoscope is the better crossover episode just because Lincoln contributed to the plot more and he was in it more. Like, he had a lot more screen time. But poor Lori was sitting at the restaurant for the whole time. She really didn't get a lot of screen time as I thought she would. But for the moments we did get Lobby in it, it was still really well done.
Yeah, it was.
So, yeah, those were all the episodes of The Loud House and The Casagrandes that came out. So, Nat, if there's any social media you want to plug for our lovely listeners right now, go right ahead.
Yeah, so I'm most active on Twitter, which is at WyomingParmesan. And you can also find me on Instagram at Wyoming2016. And I have a Tumblr as well. It's WyomingParmesan is also, but I don't get on there as much, but you guys could still follow me on there if you want, because I have a lot of stuff that you can look at.
All right. So, Nat, thank you again for coming back on my show. I appreciate you coming back.
Oh. Yeah, I love it. Like, every time you ask me to be on here, I'm just like, yay!
You know what? Since we're getting those ship episodes, I might ask you to come on again.
Yay!
I'm always gonna... go ahead.
If we get any more, like, exciting news and stuff.
Oh, yeah, I'm definitely gonna have you back on for those ship episodes.
Yay!
So thank you all for listening to Casagrande Chats, and we'll see you all next time on Casagrande Chats.